Helping Your Child Overcome Fears and Worries, a Self-Help Guide for Parents, by Cathy Creswell and Lucy Willetts. Read by Lisa Coleman, Amy Lyddon, Rachael Miller, Raj Ghatak, Steph Bauer, and Stephen Perring. Preface. Anxiety, fears, and worries are normal experiences that we all have from time to time. But in some cases, they persist and start to interfere in our lives. For children, this may bring problems at home, at school, and/or with friends. Many children experience problems with anxiety. Yet for parents and carers, it is often difficult to know what to do for the best. Your instincts might be telling you one thing. You may have found different advice on the internet, and other people may have told you to do something else entirely. Just ignore him. Make her do it. Don't give in to it. Don't upset him. This can cause confusion for parents and lead them to doubt themselves and their abilities. But we know that parents can do a fantastic job in helping their children to overcome problems with anxiety. In this book, we aim to give a clear, straightforward, step-by-step approach to help you to help your child, based on up-to-date relevant research and our clinical experience of working with hundreds of families who have experienced similar difficulties. The general approach that we follow is based on the principles of cognitive behavioural therapy, or CBT. We will explain this in simple terms throughout the book, but for now, we want to let you know that this is the gold standard or most recommended approach for overcoming child anxiety problems. Importantly, the approach that we describe in this book has undergone testing in research studies, in which we and other researchers have shown that it can be highly effective. Before we begin, it feels important for us to acknowledge that we know many parents feel a lot of guilt around their child's problems with anxiety. In our clinical work, parents often ask us if they have somehow caused the problems or made them worse. So we want to be clear up front that anxiety problems are rarely caused by one single thing, and that there are many different factors that can cause childhood anxiety to develop, some of which we will discuss in part one of this book. However, we know that parents are generally desperate to know how to help their child overcome their difficulties. And the good news is that they are in a fantastic position to do so. Who are we? We are both clinical psychologists who specialise in working with children and their families. We have worked together since 2004, when we ran a specialist childhood anxiety clinic at the University of Reading, which combined the research expertise of university-based personnel with the clinical expertise of National Health Service clinicians. Cathy continues to work at the University of Reading, where she is now a professor of developmental clinical psychology and leads the Anxiety and Depression in Children and Young People, or ANDY, research unit and clinic. Lucy now works in private practice and also provides training and supervision in this approach to a range of professionals. In our clinical work, we both often help children by working through parents, as we have found that we can get great outcomes for children by supporting parents to build both their own and their child's skills and confidence. Who is this book for? This book is aimed at parents or carers of children who are experiencing difficulties with anxiety. Where there is more than one parent or carer, it is of course wonderful if everyone involved can listen to the book and work together on helping the child. We appreciate that this can sometimes be challenging, and if it is not possible, it certainly doesn't need to get in the way of success, so please don't be put off. We have written this book for parents of primary school age children, roughly 5 to 12 years of age, However, we have added extra chapters towards the end of the book for parents of both younger and older children. The approach can be used with children with a range of anxiety problems. These might include fears and worries about social situations, separating from carers, specific things such as dogs or spiders, or more general worries about bad things happening. Two slightly different types of problems are where children experience problematic anxiety and other symptoms after experiencing a traumatic event, which may reflect post-traumatic stress, and where children experience unwanted and intrusive thoughts that drive them to do particular things over and over again, which may reflect obsessive-compulsive disorder. While some of the principles in this book may be useful for these conditions, the approach has not been developed to focus on these sorts of difficulties, nor been tested with them. If you are concerned that your child might be experiencing these, we would encourage you to contact your GP to identify more targeted support. We are often asked whether the approach will be useful for children with autistic spectrum disorders. Again, while some of the principles may be useful, we've not tested the approach with children with autistic spectrum disorders, so would again encourage you to seek additional support if it is needed. What is in this book? This book is split into three parts. In part one, we will tell you about fears, worries, and anxiety, including what anxiety problems typically look like, how anxiety problems develop, and the reasons behind the approach we have taken in this book. In part two, we take you through step-by-step techniques to help you help your child to overcome their problems with fears, worries, and anxiety. In part three, we address some specific issues that might be relevant to some, but not all, listeners. Using this book with younger children, using this book with teenagers, sleep problems, difficult behaviour, school attendance difficulties. Finally, we have also included a brief guide that can be copied and passed on to teachers or other school staff, where it would be helpful for them to be able to understand and support the approach you are taking. Throughout this book, we will be talking you through principles to help you to spot patterns or vicious cycles that your child may have become stuck in, and sharing skills and strategies either to break these cycles or prevent them from occurring. Along the way, you will hear about other parents' experiences of living with an anxious child and how they helped their child to overcome their fears and worries. These stories are based on real families that we have worked with. However, names and details have been changed to prevent identification. By sharing information, strategies, and others' experiences, our aim is to put you and your child back in control of your lives. We wish you all the very best with everything you are doing to make this happen. Part 1. Understanding Your Child's Fears and Worries. Chapter 1. What are fears, worries, and anxiety? Although it may be tempting to skip this section and get stuck straight into working on changing things, we want to strongly encourage you to take the time to listen through these first 5 brief chapters before you start on part 2. There are 3 main reasons for this. First, chapters 1, 2, and 3 describe the problem of fears, worries, and anxiety in children. By listening to them, you will be able to make sure that this is the right book for you, in the sense that it is focused on the problem that you want to work on with your child, or encourage someone else to work on with their child. Second, chapters 4 and 5 explain how fears and worries develop in young people, and what keeps these fears and worries going. The information given in these chapters provides the rationale for all the work you will do when you follow the guide in part two. Having a clear understanding of why you are doing what you are doing will make it much easier for you to put the strategies in place and will encourage you to persevere when the going is tough. Third, in part one, you will be introduced to four children: Ben, aged 9, Mohammed, 7, Layla, 11, and Sarah, 10. These children have all experienced fears and worries, and in part one, you will hear some of the background to their difficulties, before listening in part two about how their parents helped them to overcome these. We appreciate that you will be keen to get going with the central theme of the book, the actual overcoming of fears and worries, and we have therefore kept part one brief. Please do listen on. What do we mean by fears, worries, and anxiety? Everyone, children and adults alike, experiences worries, fears, and anxiety some of the time. What worries, fears, and anxiety have in common is that they involve an expectation that something bad is going to happen, a particular way in which our bodies respond to this, and certain characteristic behaviours. Anxious thinking or expectations. When people become anxious, they typically expect that something bad is about to happen. At this time, thoughts tend to become focused on the potential threat and how to escape from it, and it can be hard to think about anything else. This is clearly a useful state to be in when someone is in danger. For example, if your child is about to step into the road, you need to be focused on getting them out of the way of oncoming traffic and not be easily distracted by other thoughts, such as what you need to buy at the shops or what you're having for dinner. Bodily changes. When we experience fears and worries, we respond in a number of ways. These include our breathing getting faster, heart rate speeding up, muscles becoming tense, sweating, and butterflies in the tummy. All of these bodily signs represent our body getting ready for action, enabling us to react quickly, such as in the previous example, pulling the child out of the way before he or she comes to any harm. Anxious behaviour. The way we behave in response to fears or worries is often categorised as either fight, flight, or safety seeking. We either fight against the threat, get out of the way as quickly as we can, take flight, or do other things that we think will keep us safe. When we are faced with immediate threats, these are, of course, the most helpful ways to respond and can be essential for our survival. But when there is no objective danger, these thoughts, feelings, and behaviours can cause difficulties and get in the way of day-to-day life. So, how do I know if my child's anxiety is excessive? The changes that we experience in response to anxiety are helpful in the short term. But if these reactions continue to occur when actual danger has passed, or when in fact it was never there, they become problematic. When anxiety is excessive, thinking can become dominated by fearing the worst. Your child may always seem to expect the worst to happen and lack confidence in their ability to cope with challenges. Bodily changes can also be very uncomfortable. Children who are highly anxious often complain of tummy aches, headaches, or muscle aches. Finally, when anxiety persists, not only is it exhausting to feel constantly on edge, but also trying to keep safe can lead your child to miss out on doing things that they would otherwise enjoy. If fears and worries are getting in the way of your child enjoying themselves or being able to do the things that other children of the same age are doing, then it is important that they are helped to overcome these difficulties. This book is about giving you the tools to help your child to do just that. As we have seen, a certain amount of fear and worry is both normal and healthy. So the aim of this book is not to help you to get your child to a point where they never worry or are never scared of anything. Instead, our aim is to assist you in helping your child take control of their fears and worries so that they do not get in the way of them getting the most out of life. When children with anxiety problems receive appropriate treatment, they generally do very well. There is a lot of information in this book, but the central message is simple. Anxiety problems are extremely common among children. They can interfere with your child's life, and they can be overcome.
Key points. Anxiety is a normal emotion that everyone experiences at times. When we are anxious, we have anxious expectations, bodily signs, and engage in anxious behaviour. The approach in this book can stop anxiety interfering in your child's everyday life.
Chapter 2. How can I help my child? The fact that you're listening to this book shows that you are keen and motivated to help your child. However, you are probably also feeling quite daunted by the prospect. You will no doubt have tried many things to help your child in the past, and have probably received all sorts of different advice from different people along the way. You may well feel like you've tried everything you can, and may not feel very confident that there is anything further you can do. These sorts of experiences and concerns are very common among the parents we work with. But there are a number of reasons why we would encourage you to work with your child on overcoming their anxiety. We have listed some here. Where parents can help their child overcome their difficulties, this reduces the burden on children to attend appointments with professionals within schools or the health service, meaning children don't miss out on other age-appropriate activities that they could be doing. Parents are often in a better position than therapists to put strategies in place and to create opportunities for new learning in their child's day-to-day life. Parents are often more motivated than the child to make changes, as children may be more focused on the short-term pain, whereas parents are likely to be more focused on the long-term gain. Parents can sometimes put the strategies in place across the family, potentially helping other children and sometimes adults within the family. Parents are more likely to remember what has been helpful in the months and years that follow, and so are in a great position to put these strategies in place in the future if problems come up again. Parents are often the ones having to manage their child's difficulties on a day-to-day basis. This can be enormously stressful, and parents tell us that they want strategies to help them know what to do. For all these reasons, we believe that parents are in a strong and unique position to help their children overcome fears and worries. The aim of this book is to help you to feel skilled and confident in how to do this. Does it work? In recent years, there have been a number of studies that have tested out treatments for children with anxiety disorders, in which parents are supported in helping their child, and where the child is not seen by the therapist at all. In these studies, parents of 5 to 12-year-old children are typically given a book like this and are supported by a therapist in putting the strategies it contains in place. Often, the therapist's role is to help keep the parent focused on using the strategies within their busy lives. But the therapist might also provide opportunities to practice particular strategies or problem-solve any difficulties that arise. These studies have shown that this is an effective treatment approach, and in some cases, it has been as effective as far more intensive family-focused treatments, in which the child and parent attend regular sessions with a therapist. What if it doesn't work? Our experience suggests that using this book with your child over around 2 months can lead to huge progress within that time. For some, initial improvements may be slower and happen in the months that follow. So if you do not see change straight away, do not give up. If, however, on finishing working through the book, you feel you need more support, then we would strongly advise you to seek help via your GP or school. They can advise on services available to you locally that can support you in applying the principles in this book, or offer other approaches depending on the difficulties your child is experiencing. We know that parents can be reluctant to seek help for their child for many reasons. For example, they may feel that they will be judged in some way. They think they should be able to manage the difficulties within their own family. And they think it is not a medical doctor's job to deal with these sorts of problems. However, it is important to recognise that these sorts of difficulties are common. They are experienced by all sorts of different families with all sorts of different backgrounds. That effective treatments are available, and that GPs will often see children with these sorts of difficulties and will be able to help you access support. So, if you are concerned, please do ask for help.
Key points. You are in a unique position to help your child overcome their fears and worries. Our research suggests working through parents to help children is effective. Seek help through your child's GP or school if you find you need additional support.
Chapter 3. Common fears and worries experienced by children. All children will experience fears and worries in different ways. And while using this book, it is important for you to try to get a clear understanding of your child's unique experience. Every family we work with describes an experience that we have not heard about before. However, they all have a great deal in common with other families. The basic patterns of anxious thinking, behaviour, and physical symptoms have been described in Chapter 1. However, we can also group certain types of anxiety problems together based on more specific features or symptoms. These groups of anxiety problems have been given labels called diagnoses. The most common categories of anxiety problems among children are specific phobias, social anxiety, generalized anxiety, and separation anxiety. These different sorts of difficulties often go hand in hand. In fact, among the children we work with, seeing a child who has just one of these types of anxiety is the exception rather than the rule. We'll now describe what is meant by each of these categories. Specific phobias. When a fear of a particular place, object, or situation becomes a problem, it is called a phobia. This describes a fear that is excessive and leads to avoidance or extreme discomfort when a child is faced with the feared object, or place, or situation. Fears are common. A lot of people are cautious of, for example, snakes or bees, and this can be a healthy response. If, however, your child's fear is significantly interfering with his or her life, such as causing problems at school, in the family or with friends, or if it stops him or her from doing things he or she would like to do, then it would no doubt be best for your child to receive help in overcoming this fear. Common fears we see in children include fears of dogs, heights, injections, and vomiting. Sarah, aged 10.
Sarah's never liked spiders. I remember when she was just a toddler. She once became hysterical because she saw a bit of fluff on the carpet which looked a bit like a spider. Since then, she's always had to keep away if we came across a spider in the room, but it never used to cause a big problem. Over time, it just seems to have got worse. Now we're finding that there are certain places that Sarah won't want to go because she thinks we're likely to see a spider. For example, her granddad had to go to hospital for a month, so his flat was empty for all that time. We went over to give it a clean-up before he came home. We shouldn't have taken Sarah with us, really, because, not surprisingly, we came across a spider before too long. Sarah got really upset and was out the door before you could do anything about it. Since then, she's refused to go back to her granddad's house, so he always has to come to us to visit, which feels unfair on him.
Social anxiety. When a child is socially anxious, they are typically anxious about a variety of different situations in which they fear doing something embarrassing, that people will think they are stupid, judge them negatively, or react badly to them. For children, this can make it difficult to enter into situations where there will be other people. For example, going to school, being with other children, such as at parties, and going to cafes or restaurants. It may also make it hard for a child to participate in a social situation, for example, not being able to put their hand up in class or talk in a large group of peers. Although children who are socially anxious may be perfectly comfortable when they are with people they know well, they may try to avoid situations where there will be less familiar people, or may feel very uncomfortable if they have to be in these kinds of situations. Occasionally, when social anxiety is severe, children are not able to talk at all in certain situations, such as at school or with people outside of their home. This is commonly referred to as selective mutism. Generalized anxiety. Generalized anxiety describes a condition where a child worries excessively and finds it hard to get worries out of his or her mind. The worries tend to be about a range of different concerns, rather than a single issue. For example, common worries can include things going on in the world, such as terrorism, doing well at school, friendships, getting things right, and the health of ourselves and others. For some children, the worries change over time, so a child can move from worrying about one thing to something else. The worries are often accompanied by unpleasant physical symptoms, such as difficulty concentrating, muscle aches, sleep problems, difficulty settling or frequent waking, irritability, and tiredness. Again, these difficulties can interfere with the child's ability to enjoy activities at home, school, in the family, or with friends. Generalized anxiety can present a bit differently from some of the other anxiety problems, with more worry and less avoidance. And for this reason, there are some particular strategies that work well, which we will discuss in Chapter 12. Ben, aged 9.
The best way to describe Ben is as a worrier. He seems to worry about anything and everything. I've stopped putting the news on when he's around because it's like he's on the lookout for bad news. For example, he's terrified that we're all going to catch the illness that has been talked about on the news that is happening on the other side of the world. He also gets really wound up when his dad has to go into the city for work, as he's seen stories about bombs and terrorism. I suppose I can understand those worries, but there are others I find harder. He just gets something into his head and it seems to get stuck there, like he's had a real worry about a monster that was in a film that he watched at his cousin's house. He's convinced that if he goes upstairs, the monster is going to come and get him, to the point that he won't go upstairs on his own. We tell him that there is no monster. It was just a made-up character, and just to forget about it. But he just can't seem to get rid of this thought. Since this has been going on, he's had to share a bedroom with his brother. But it takes Ben so long to get to sleep at night because he's worrying about something or other that this is now disturbing his brother's sleep too.
Separation anxiety. Some children find it extremely difficult to be apart from a parent or other carer. This often relates to a fear that if they are separated from their carer, they will not see each other again. This can either be because of a fear that some harm will come to the child if their carer is not present, such as they will get taken or injured, or that harm will come to their carer in the child's absence. These fears can make it difficult for a child to take part in a range of activities that other children of the same age will be doing, including attending school, visiting friends, going to after-school clubs or activities, or going on sleepovers. Mohammed, aged 7.
There are a lot of things Mohammed finds difficult, but I think the one thing I struggle with the most is bedtime. Mohammed needs to have me or his dad there with him for him to go to sleep. We feel like we have tried everything. We have insisted he stay in his room and have let him cry, but he just got himself so worked up that it seemed to make things worse. We decorated his room for him so that it would be a nice place to be. None of these things have made any difference. What tends to happen is that one of us will go in with Mohammed and read him a story, and then we have to lie down on his bed with him until he drops off. Quite often we'll end up dropping off too. Then we lose a big chunk of our evening. Then when we finally do get to bed, more often than not we'll be woken up to find Mohammed has crept in too at some point in the night. I think the fact that none of us are getting enough sleep is making everything else harder to deal with. The other big thing is, of course, school. Mohammed has missed a great deal of school this year as he just finds it so difficult, and we just don't have the energy to keep pushing him to go anymore. It just doesn't seem like it can be good for him to go through so much stress each day. I try to imagine him 10 years from now. He certainly can't be coming into our bed then. Something has to be done.
How common are anxiety problems in children? Anxiety problems are the most common form of emotional and behavioural problems experienced by young people. Studies have estimated that about 6.5% of children worldwide meet criteria for a diagnosis of an anxiety disorder. By that, we mean a level of anxiety that is leading to high levels of distress and or is causing them to miss out on age-appropriate opportunities. In other words, more than one in every 20 children is likely to have an anxiety problem that gets in the way of their day-to-day life. In terms of particular types of anxiety disorders, findings vary across studies, but phobias have been found to affect up to a quarter of children, and other anxiety disorders like separation anxiety disorder can affect up to 1 in 5 children. Separation anxiety disorder is more commonly found among pre-adolescent children than adolescents. And social anxiety disorder is more common among adolescents than pre-adolescent children. The effects on children's lives. The effects on social life. Mohammed
is at an age now where his friends are starting to sleep over at each other's houses and go away to camps and things like that. We've tried to get Mohammed along to an after-school football club, but he'll only join in if he knows he will be able to see me at all times. He has a school journey coming up next term where they will stay away for 3 nights. I think there is no way he'll be able to go. I feel like he is really missing out, and I worry that his friends are going to lose interest as he gets older if Mum or Dad are always hanging about.
It is easy to see how certain anxiety problems can affect children's developing social lives. Throughout childhood, friendships are essential for children to learn and practice what they need to know to form lasting relationships. They also provide an essential reference point for children to discover that many of the challenges they experience are quite normal. Friends also, of course, provide opportunities for fun and encourage and motivate each other to try new experiences. Throughout childhood and adolescence, relationships between friends are constantly changing. When anxiety causes a child to withdraw from their friends at school or other social opportunities, a vicious cycle can form, because changes that have occurred within their group of friends make it harder for the child to join it again. For instance, they may have anxiety about joining in with peers, so they stay in at break time or stay with the teacher, which can lead to missing out on shared activities or chances to build friendships, which can lead to feelings of being left out at school, which leads back onto anxiety about joining in with peers. A vicious cycle created when a child withdraws at school. And the cycle continues. The effects on academic performance. There is no reason to think that children who have problems with anxiety are any less bright than children who do not have anxiety problems. Despite this, children with anxiety problems do tend to experience more academic problems. This is likely to be because their anxiety is preventing them from achieving their full potential. Again, a vicious cycle can develop in which not asking for help, difficulties concentrating and taking in new information, or even missing lessons caused by worry in the classroom, leads to problems with school, which in turn leads to greater anxiety about being able to get the work done. Layla.
Layla is now having a real problem at school. The fact that she misses more days from school than most children because she makes herself so ill isn't a good start. She has always struggled a bit with her work, but it is just getting worse and worse now, as she isn't getting the help she needs because she never lets the teacher know that she needs it. She also says that she can't remember what the teacher has asked her to do, as her mind was full with worries about things going wrong.
The effects on mood. Some children who experience significant anxiety problems also experience symptoms of low mood or depression, such as loss of interest in their usual activities, tearfulness or irritability, feelings of worthlessness, and physical symptoms such as poor appetite and sleep problems. All children, and adults for that matter, feel down from time to time. But if these kinds of feelings continue for a period of 2 weeks or more, and it seems impossible to lift your child out of this low mood, then it will be important to address this. The strategies that are described in part 2 of this book are useful skills for life and can be helpful for overcoming mild to moderate low mood. If this applies to your child, you may find that by helping them to overcome their fears or worries, they will begin to feel better about themselves and be more able to participate in activities that they find fulfilling. However, if your child is extremely withdrawn and lacking in motivation, you may find it difficult to apply some of the strategies that we will introduce you to. In this case, we would recommend you visit your GP to discuss ways that you and your child could access greater support to help improve their mood before embarking on this programme. Ben.
Ben just seems to have the weight of the world on his shoulders. It seems like such a rare occurrence that I see him laugh or smile. It makes me really sad to think that such a young boy feels that way. Other children his age seem to be laughing and joking without a care. I just wish he could be the same way.
Will my child grow out of this problem? Studies that have kept in touch with children with anxiety disorders over time have tended to report that symptoms can persist for several years. When we consider the effects that anxiety problems can have on children's social lives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.